प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्याम् मामा ब्रह्म निराकरोत् अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मे अस्तु तदात्मनि निरते यौपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेदि मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः ॐ इत्येतदक्षरमुद्गीतमुपासीत ओमिति ह्युद्गायते तस्योपव्याख्यानम् तदनन्यत्वम् आरम्भणशब्दादिभ्यः So the two questions were taken up here. Asatyat satyam jayate, asatyat satyasya jnanam jayate nava. From asatya, from that which is unreal, is it possible that satya be born from the real? Can we be born from unreal? Or satyasya jnanam, the knowledge of satyam, the knowledge of real can be born from unreal? Both of these are possible. For that, Bhashyakara gave quoted from the Shruti on the page 379, Tathacha Shrutihi. This Chandogya Upanishad already said this. Yada karma sukamyeshu striyam svapneshu pashyate. When a person is doing some kamya karma, performing some ritual or doing upasana with a desire, with an intention to fulfill some desire, sakama karma. Striyam svapneshu pashyati. If that person sees a woman in the dream, samruddhim tatva janiyat tasmin svapna indarshane. From that experience of dream, one should conclude that one's ritual or the upasana, the meditation, will be successful, meaning the desire with which the karma, the upasana are performed, that desire will be fulfilled. Iti asatyena svapna darshanena satyayaha samruddhe pratipattim darshayati. So, svapna darshanam is asatyam, because that woman in the svapna also is asatya. Therefore, darshanam also is asatya. From asatya svapna darshanam, from the experience of dream. So dream is unreal, and therefore that experience also is called unreal. From that, the real prediction can be made. So satyayaha samruddhe pratipattim darshayati. The success that this person will gain from this ritual or meditation is real. The knowledge of the real success is born from the unreal knowledge of the unreal dream. event. So this is the when success is going to come. The dreams can also indicate the opposite, the calamity that may happen. Tatha pratyaksha darshaneshu keshuchit arishteshu jateshu. There is a discussion about arishta, about the evil omens, bad omens. So when you come across these bad omens, then what effect can be there? That's the general, that is the discussion. Na chirameva jivishyati iti vidyat. That sudden bad omen means that this fellow will not live long. Iti uktva. So having commenced the discussion in that way. Atha svapne purusha krishnam krishnadantam pashyati sa enam hante. Even in a dream, a person sees a black man with black teeth. Then that darshanam, that seeing of the black man with black teeth, will kill this person. Ityadena tena tena asatyena svapna darshanena satyam maranam suchate iti darshayati. So again, from asatya svapna darshanam, the unreal dream and the knowledge, again the real prediction of death, etc., can be made. So this is the asatyat satyat satyasya utpattihi. From asatya, satya is born, or satya jnanam is born. Prasiddham chaidam loke anvaya vyatireka kushalanam idushena svapna darshanena sadhvagama suchyate idushena asadhvagama iti. Also, it is well known that there are people who are adept in interpreting dream, and they say that if a dream of a certain kind takes place, then you should expect some desirable thing will happen. On the other hand, if a certain kind of a dream takes place, then you should know that an undesirable thing will happen. Meaning that people are able to predict the possible events based on the interpretation of dream, which is unreal. So that also shows the knowledge of the real from the unreal. Asatyat satyasya jnanam jayate. This is the experience. Then, tatha akaradi satyakshara pratipatti drushta rekha anrutra akshara pratipatte. Then says, rekha anrutra akshara. On the paper, you draw an A. Now, rekha, the line is real, but that it is A is unreal, understand? Upon a given scribbling of the lines or given drawing of the lines, you are superimposing the idea of A, B, C. Same sound A, other people superimpose upon other lines, like we write A in a certain way. In Hindi, A is written in a different way. Sound is A. So line is real, but that it is A is unreal, understand? So Bhashyakara said, anuruta akshara pratipatte hai. Rekha anuruta akshara pratipatte hai. From the knowledge of the unreal letter, which is superimposed upon a line, akaradi satyakshara pratipatti, you say A. So looking at that drawing on the paper, you say A, A, E. Now A, I are real because they are known from language. They are sounds and they are real sounds. But the knowledge of the real sound or real letter comes from the unreal letter which is superimposed upon the line. So again, from the unreal or asatya, satya jnanam, the knowledge of real is born. said Ratna Prabha, Tatha Kalpitanapi Vedantanam Satya Brahma Bodhakatvam Sambhavati Iti Tatvikam Pramanyam Iti Bhavaha. The gist of this discussion is that it is said that Vedanta also is Asatya. The Vedas also, being part of creation, also have the same reality as the creation, which is Mithya or Asatya. How can the knowledge of Satya Brahma take place from the teaching of Vedanta, which is Asatya? So therefore, several examples were given as to how the knowledge of Satya takes place from the Asatya. Similarly, even though Vedanta may be Asatya or Mithya, as far as the reality is concerned, still Satya Brahma Bodhakatvam Sambhavati Icho Sambhavana. I mean, you see, this is a matter of reasoning. The reasoning is that how can the real be born of unreal, or knowledge of real be born of unreal? For that, there is no rule, that's all. There is no rule that knowledge of real cannot be born of unreal. That was shown with several examples. Therefore, even though the Vedas are unreal, it is quite possible that the knowledge of the real Brahma takes place. So, Bhashyakara showed the exception to the rule. How can the knowledge of real be born of unreal? That's the rule. So, Dvitiya Niyamasya Shrutya Vibhicharamaha. By Shruti, the exception to the rule has been shown. And by Vyavahara, like Rekha, Akshara, etc., it is shown how the knowledge of the real can be born of unreal. And therefore, even though Vedas are unreal, the knowledge of Brahman that is real can be born of them. Yaduktam ekatva nanatva vyavahara siddhe ubhayam satyamiti. So Purvapakshi wants to say that Vedas are real. And from the real Vedas, the knowledge of reality is born. This is their contention. Vedas are real means duality also is real. So ekatva nanatva vyavahara siddhe. The Shruti talks about both tattvamasi aham brahmasmi, that ekatva also is taught. And vyavahara, of course, is there, which involves duality. So you cannot say that this vyavahara, this interaction is not taking place. You can't say that. You cannot say that I am a speaker. You can't say I am a speaker and spoken and vyavahara is not there. It's there. And so this vyavahara also is real. And the non-duality also is real. And duality also is real. This is their comfort. So the reality, the truth, consists of the duality and non-duality. It's a composite entity. There are two states of the reality, the cause and the effect. At the level of cause, there is non-duality. The level of effect, there is duality. So this kind of a position they have developed to explain the vyavahara. Vedantin says, no, you do not have to imagine that the duality is real to explain this vyavahara. Just because you think that the duality is real does not mean that duality has to be real. Just as when you are experiencing dream, at that time you think that all that transaction is real. But just because you think dream is real at the time of dream does not mean it is real, because you yourself realize after waking up that the dream was mithya. Similarly to you, this duality appears real does not mean it has to be real. This is the Vedantin's approach, the Vedantin's position. Therefore, Vedantin says that to explain the Vyavahara, you do not have to imagine that the duality is real. Vedasya lokasiddhasya apurva phalavat abheda virodhena satyatva kalpana ayogat. Because Veda, the duality, is opposed to non-duality. And now let us ask this question. What is the benefit of the knowledge of duality? And what is the benefit of the knowledge of non-duality? Apurva phalavat. So, upakramopasamharau abhyasah apurvata phalam. So, the pramana always is apurvata. Vedanta is pramana. Therefore, it gives rise to knowledge which is unique. Eyes are the pramana means of knowledge, and eyes give us the knowledge of colors and form which is unique, which means that the colors and forms cannot be known by any other means of knowledge. Then alone it is called pramanam, svatah pramanam. Similarly, Vedanta is pramanam. It gives rise to knowledge of non-duality. Vedanta vijnana sunischidarthaha. Vedanta gives vijnanam, vishishtam jnanam. Aham brahmasmiti, I am Brahman. This is vishishtam jnanam. This unique kind of knowledge Vedanta gives. And is this knowledge beneficial? Is there any benefit in knowing the non-duality? There is. Because the samsara born of the notion of duality is completely eliminated. And one discovers the limitlessness of the self, and therefore one becomes free from all the grief and delusion. Apurva phalavat. This knowledge of non-duality is phalavat, is beneficial. And the benefit that comes from that knowledge also is unique, which cannot come from any other knowledge, you know. Knowledge may give rise to benefit, but this knowledge of non-duality gives rise to a benefit which cannot be gained from any other knowledge. Apurva phalavat virodhena. And by knowing duality, what do you get? What is knowledge of duality? I am a jiva, like Narayana. That you are Narayana, I am not Narayana. And so, what is new in that? By knowing that I am a limited entity, that Ishvara is different from me, what's the benefit? All the sense of limitation remains, and therefore all the sorrow remains in life. Therefore, the knowledge of duality does not yield any benefit. Therefore, it is not of the same category as non-duality, which is phalavat. This is the nishphalam, without any phala, without any benefit. Therefore, abheda virodhena satyatva kalpana ayogat. If the knowledge of duality also gave rise to a desirable result, then you can say that duality is real because its knowledge gives rise to a desirable result, but it does not. Kincha yat ubhayoho ekada vyavaharasyat tada syadavi satyatvam. So forget about the benefit. But if duality and non-duality coexisted, there is non-duality also, at the same time there is duality also. If they coexisted, then we can say that both of them enjoy the same degree of reality. If the pot and clay coexisted, then we can say that both of them enjoy the same degree of reality. But in the knowledge that this object is clay, the pot does not remain. In your own mind, when your mind is preoccupied with the thought of clay, the pot nowhere remains, meaning that the knowledge of clay has negated the knowledge of pot. So really speaking, the clay and pot do not exist simultaneously. Where the clay is, there the pot is not. Where the pot is, there the clay is. But where the clay is, there the pot is not. So where duality is, there non-duality is. But where non-duality is, duality is not. Machthani sarabhudani nachaham teshu avasthitah. They are all in me. They are all superimposed upon me. I am not in them. Therefore, nacha machthani bhutani. In fact, the bhutani, the duality, is not in me at all. Kincha yadi ubhayoho ekada vyavahara syat tada syadabhi satyatvam. Even though the knowledge of duality does not yield any benefit, still if it coexisted with non-duality, then we may accept that all right, duality as reality. Naivam asti, but that is not so. That non-duality is where the duality is, but the duality is not where the non-duality is. Ekatva jnanena charamena anapekshena nanatvasya nishesham badhat. Charamena, this knowledge of non-duality is the ultimate knowledge, beyond which there is no knowledge. That knowledge which is not subject to any correction or improvement. You see, in the realm of duality, whatever knowledge you get is always subject to correction. So what we understand today will be corrected by what we will know after 10, 15, 25 years. Definitely. Therefore, nothing is final knowledge. This is Swamiji, medical science is imperfect. Everything is imperfect. There is no final word about anything when it comes to duality, because duality is not real. Therefore, there is no final word that this is what it is and not something else. This is what it is from this standpoint, that is, this is what it is from the other standpoint. So Swamiji always used to hold a chain in his hand and ask this question, what is his object? Somebody says, it is chain. Another fellow who has never seen a chain, who comes from a village, says it is gold. So chain is only relative. Thus everything in the universe is relative. Whenever you say that this is what this is, you must always qualify it by saying that under these circumstances, from this standpoint, at this time, at this place, this is what this is. In Jain Shastra it is called Syadavada. That there is no finality about anything in duality. They think that that is reality, of course. According to them, that syad is reality. We say, no, that syad only shows, syad means may it be this and may it be that. It shows mithyatvam. And that shows that there must be reality. And therefore, ekatva jnayena charamena. That is charamam jnanam, ultimate knowledge, conclusive knowledge, having gained which there is no further improvement. That's very important. Swamiji, if somebody tomorrow comes and says that jiva is eternal, that suppose the scientist develops something by which the body does not die, what will happen to Vedanta? And nothing will happen to Vedanta. Vedanta is Atma is not the body, whatever the attribute of body may be. But Vedantic students ask this question, so what will happen to Vedanta? So nothing will happen to Vedanta. Nishesham badha. Remember, the in the knowledge of clay, the part is completely negated, meaning that the knowledge, the clay thought will completely replace the part thought. That's called nirvikalpa samadhi anyway. Savikalpa samadhi is where the knowledge of part also is there and knowledge of clay also is there. But that knowledge of part is negatable, that even that much knowledge may not be there. And your mind may be completely occupied by the knowledge of clay. It is possible because clay enjoys independent reality, pot enjoys only a dependent reality, and therefore it can be completely excluded. Whereas, regardless of what you do, you can never get rid of the thought of clay from your mind with reference to clay pot. That when you are perceiving a pot, you can never exclude the thought of clay from your mind, understand? Whereas you can exclude the thought of pot. Here of course example is Shukti Jnanena Rajasasyeti. Then it's called Jiva Srishti. This example of clay pot was an Ishva Srishti. But here also, Rajasya Shuktika Jnanena Rajatasyeva, just as in case of the shell upon which silver is superimposed, how the knowledge of silver is completely negated by the knowledge of shell. So Bhashyakara said, Apicha अंतमिदं प्रमाणं आत्मैकत्वस्य प्रतिपादके न प्रतिपादकं न तः परं किञ्चित् आकांक्षम् अस्ति. आत्मैकत्वस्य प्रतिपादकं दैट प्रमाणं वेदांत विच रिवील्स the non-duality of the self is the ultimate. There is nothing beyond that. Somebody asked Swamiji, Swamiji, what if there is improvement upon Vedanta? So he says, I am telling you, you are limitless, improve upon that. You are limitless, improve upon that. That is called limitless, which is not subject to improvement or disprovement, whatever, you know. Where there cannot be growth or decay. So this is Vedantin claims that there cannot be any superior knowledge, there cannot be a knowledge that contradicts this one or that improves upon this one, let alone negating this one. That's the reason why it is eternal. Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi, these Mahavakyas which reveal the oneness of all existence. That's the ultimate in knowledge. Yajnatva nehabhoyanya jnatavyam avashishyate, having known which nothing whatever remains to be known. So Vashyakara says, Yathahi loke yajeta iti ukte kim kena katham iti akangshate. Yajeta, one should perform this yaga. Only yajeta, he said, perform this, enjoin this. that may one sacrifice yajeta, may one worship yajeta. Then kim yajeta? Next question arises, what should I worship? Kena yajeta? If worship is to be carried out, how to worship Ganapati, for example? Katham yajeta? What's the manner? Should we perform abhisheka? Should we perform archana? Should we perform? What should we do? So merely when it said, may you worship, this question of what should I worship, with what I should worship, what are the materials? Because every devata has his or her liking, and therefore what suits one devata may not suit another devata. And there are different ways of carrying out the abhisheka, archana. And that being the case, these questions remain. Naivam tattvamasi aham brahmasmi iti ukte kinchit anyat akankshamasti. But when it said, I am Brahman, or that you are Brahman, nothing more, no expectancy or no question remains. What? Brahma. Who? You. All questions are answered. How? That's the reality. So, kim, kena, katham, these questions automatically get answered in the realization that I am Brahman. Now, understand that knowledge is the knowledge of reality, that I am Brahman. For what reason? Because that's my nature. So, in nature, there cannot be any questions. Fire is hot. Why? It's hot. How? It is hot. By whom? You know, all these questions, they don't remain when it comes to nature, because it is self-existing and self, in this case, self-revealing. So why am I Brahman? How am I Brahman? Who is Brahman? All questions automatically are answered, because Brahman happens to be my nature. In nature, there cannot be any questions. Kinchit anyat akanksham nasti sarvatmaikatva vishayatva avagate hai. Further. Alright, Swamiji, I have known the Atma, alright, but what about knowing Anatma? There is no such thing. When you really know what Atma is, there is no such entity as Anatma remains. Because Atma is all-inclusive. As long as Atma is not known, so long Atma, Anatma, Viveka is carried out, that Atma is Drashta, Atma is Sakshi, Atma is witness, that is how At Sakshi Cheta, that is all said. Kevalaha. But when you examine the nature of Sakshi witness also, he turns out to be pure consciousness and nothing else. Cheta kevalah nirgunascha. So having known Atma, there is no Anatma remaining, because Atma includes. When you know this object as clay, then, well, I have known this part. How about other parts? Well, all parts are known when you know clay. That is how Eka Vijnanena Sarva Vijnanam, which is the theme of Chandogya Upanishad. By knowing one thing, you know everything. Sarvatma Ekatva Vishayatva Avagatehe. That Atma is Sarvatma. The Self is the Self of all. And therefore, nothing remains to be known, because what is Self? What is Ishvara? What is Brahman? What is Self? Sarvam Brahma Upanishadam. What is Brahma? Revealed by the Upanishads, or known by the Upanishads. Therefore, nothing remains to be known, no akanksha remains. Having known Atma, but Swamiji, this remains unknown to me. I do not know this thing, I do not know that thing. See, if you know one object like clay, then what about pot, what about cloth, what about table, what about chair? Because clock does not include all those objects. Clock excludes everything other than itself. Whereas Atma includes everything. Apnoti iti Atma, that is pervades everything. Atma ityeva upasita. Therefore, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says that may one look upon oneself as Atma, is all pervasive, all inclusive. Sati anyasmin avashishyamane arthe akanksha syat. Having known Atma, if something other than Atma existed, then you say, I have only known Atma, but I have not known this thing. There is no anatma separate from Atma. Meaning there are no pots and pans and pitchers separate from clay. For from the standpoint of clay, there is no anatma, understand. As long as you have not known the pot as clay, so long you feel that there are so many pots. And by knowing one pot, the other pot is not known. When you know that the pot is clay, clay being the sarvatmaikatva vijnanam, that is atma of all inclusive endeavor, nothing remains to be known. Nadu atmaikatva vyatarekena avashishyamana anya arthasti ya akankshya. Very, very important things. Atmaikatva vyatarekena, other than the non-dual self, there is na shishyamana, avashishyamana, anyarthasti. There is no object or no entity that remains other than the Atma, that is non-dual or all-inclusive. Ya akankshyeta, nothing stands apart from Atma. Therefore, when Atma is known, everything is as well known, and therefore no akanksha remains. If something remains other than Atma, then that could be as real as Atma. So even though the pot and clay appears to be in one location, they are not, understand. Clay and pot are not in one location. Although we put them in one locus, we do samanadhikaranam, but they are not in one adhikaranam. Clay is real, pot is superimposed, understand. So clay has its being in reality, pot has its being in non-reality, therefore they do not coexist. We superimpose coexistent and then we call it clay pot, but they don't coexist. Astibhadi priyam nama rupa, the name and form do not coexist with astibhadi priyam. Astibhadi priyam is Brahman, Atma, the reality. Name and form are superimposed upon that. Then says Ratnabraha on the page 379, Nanu upajivya dvaita pramana virodhat ekatva vagatihi na utpadyate iti. He dvaita pramana. Pratyaksha pramana, the basis of all pramanas. So pratyaksha is called mukhya pramana, upajivya. All other pramanas depend upon that. Pratyaksha is perception. Inference also depends upon pratyaksha. So pratyaksha sustains, gives life to everything else. Livelihood. That everything exists because of pratyaksha. Inference is possible only when there is a perception of smoke, then alone you can infer the existence of fire. Therefore, inference also requires perception. And so also arthabhatti. Pino devadatta divana bhungte. The devadatta is fat and sees, is seen not to eat during the day, therefore he must be eating at night. But Devadatta and fat Devadatta is a matter of knowledge, perception. Otherwise, how do we presume? Or that you see that he does not eat during the day, then you presume that he must be eating at night. Then, upamanam, comparison between go and gavaya. So, gavaya is an animal similar to go or cow. When you see in cow, then you can see, when you see in the forest an animal similar to cow but not cow, then you infer or then you conclude that this is gavaya. But that also requires perception of go. Thus, every pramanam, when somebody describes to you the Eiffel Tower which you haven't seen, then you construct a picture in your mind based on what you know. So, shabda in vyavahara also gives knowledge based on perception. Anupalabdhi is non-perception. Of course, takes that there is no elephant on my hand or my palm, but that needs another elephant and palm. So, upajivya. So, this is the... Similarly, Vedanta also is pramana. All the pramanas have their basis in perception, which is the pramanam or the means of knowledge of duality. And Vedanta also is pramanam. Therefore, perception should sustain Vedanta also, like all the pramanas depend upon dvaita or perception. So, also Vedanta should depend upon perception. And your non-duality opposes the perception, says there is duality, which opposes the idea of non-duality. If inference opposes perception, then it cannot be right. Suppose you infer that there is fire and you go to that place and there is no fire, that means inference is wrong. So maybe you inferred in a wrong way. What was there was only dust, cloud of dust. And you mistook that to be smoke and then concluded that there is fire there, and then you discover there is no fire. Then you can say that that's a wrong, that there is fire, there is a wrong knowledge, because it is opposed by the perception. You know? Similarly, you constructed a picture of Eiffel Tower. When you really go and see, you find, hey, it's a different kind of a thing. Then what Shabda said was not right. So ultimate proof is only in perception, as far as all other pramanas are concerned. Because perception gives you immediate knowledge, pratyaksha jnanam. All other pramanas give paroksha jnanam. They give only the remote knowledge, not immediate knowledge. So ultimate verification should happen by pratyaksha. So similarly, now your Vedanta gives the knowledge of non-duality. But perception says, I am different and world is different, therefore there is duality. So since what Vedanta says is contradicted by perception, which is the means of knowledge and duality, therefore we say that the knowledge of non-duality cannot arise because it's not there. Therefore, ekatvavagatihi na utpadyate iti. Avagati means knowledge. Ekatva avagatihi, the knowledge of non-duality does not arise. That's what we say. To that, the answer is given, nachayemeti. Bhashyakara says in the last line, nachayem avagatihi na utpadyate iti shakyam vaktum tadhasya vijagnyau ityadi shrutibhyah. Nacha iyam avagatihi. Avagati means knowledge. Iyam avagatihi, this knowledge of non-duality does not happen, will not take place, because it is opposed by duality. So duality is real, therefore the non-knowledge of non-duality will not take place. That's what he says. The knowledge of non-duality can take place provided non-duality is, we say it is not there. Why is it not there? Because perception reveals duality. Therefore, non-duality is not there. So how can knowledge of non-duality take place when it is not there? Knowledge of the horn on my head cannot take place because it is not there. Suppose some pandita comes and says, describes a horn on the Swami's head, let us say. He is an authority. Whether he is an authority or not, that horn on the head cannot be verified by perception. That being the case, it is not there. And therefore, regardless of what you do, the knowledge of the horn on the head will not take place. Similarly, the perception of duality contradicts the non-duality. Therefore, we say that non-duality is not there. And therefore, regardless of what you do, regardless of what Upanishad says, that knowledge will not take place. You can't say that. Vedantin says, Nacha iyam avagatihi na utpadyate iti shakyam vaktum. That this knowledge does not take place, you cannot say that. Why? There is an evidence that it took place. Tathasya vijagnyau. This Chandogya Upanishad itself will say in the 6th chapter that as a result of teaching by Sage Uddalaka, Shvetaketu came to know. Even Kathopanishad also says that Nachiketa came to know, or as Nyanayana says, Adi Shabdat Anando Brahmeti Vyajanat. That Bhrugu also knew that Ananda is Brahma, Vyajanat, he knew. So there is evidence that these people have come to know. So you can't say that knowledge doesn't take place because there is evidence that they came to know. So taddasya vijagnyau, says Ratnaprabha, tat kila atatattvam asya pituhu vakyat svetaketuhu vijagnyau vijnanavaniti vijnatavaniti jnanotpatte shrutatvat. So that statement is explained. Taddasya vijagnyau, tat meaning what? Atmatattva, that very famous Atmatattva. Asya pituhu vakyat, by the words of the father who is also the teacher. Vijagnyau, he knew who he, Svetaketuhu vijagnyau vijnatavan. Svetaketu came to know the truth from the teaching of the father. Iti jnanotpatte shrutatvad. So clearly says that jnanotpatti, the occurrence of knowledge, took place. So you can't say, now you can't say it does not take place because you say it took place. Ityadi deva adi shruti, adi shabdat, anando brahmeti vyajanat, iti shruti hi grihyate. So says Ratnaprabha, Vyavaharika Guru Shishyadi Vedam Upajivya Gnayamana Vakyartha Avagatehe Pratyakshagatam Vyavaharikam Praman Upajivyam Tacha Paramarthika Ekatogatya Naviruddhyate. It's the other way around. Your Pratyaksha depends upon non-duality, not the other way around. Vyavharika Guru Shishyadi Vedam Upajivya. That, so this Vada Upadeshat, Ayam Vada. For the purpose of Upadesha, this Vada or this arrangement is that there is Guru and there is Shishya. Vedam Upajivya Jnayamana Vakyartha Avagatehe. So this Vakyartha Avagatehe. The knowledge of Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi, is of course known based on this duality of Guru and Shishya. So, therefore, that duality of between Guru and Shishya indeed is the basis of the occurrence of knowledge of non-duality on the part of the disciple from the words of the teacher. Pratyakshagatam vyavaharikam pramanam upajivyam. And so you can say that way the pratyaksha etc. is upajivya, is the basis of the knowledge of Vedanta. Tachya parmatika ekat avagatya na virudyate. But this duality of the Guru and Shishya also is not opposed to non-duality between Guru and Shishya. That is a spot and pan and pitcher, they are not opposed to the fact that they are clay. Similarly, both Guru and Shishya are Brahma, so the duality obtaining in Vyavahara between Guru and Shishya is not opposed to the non-duality between Guru and Shishya. That there is non-duality in spite of duality. There is non-duality of clay in spite of manyness of the pots and pans, not the exclusion of that. So, paramarthika ekatvavagatya na virudyate. We accept that pratyaksha is a basis. The duality is a basis of non-duality in that sense. The duality of the Guru Shishya, the teacher and taught, is required for the knowledge of non-duality to take place. In that sense, you can say that the pratyaksha of perception is a basis. But that duality does not oppose the knowledge of non-duality. So, paramarthika ekatvagatya na virudyate. Then you realize that, yeah, Guru Shishya is alright different, but non-different also. When you know that the clay and the pitcher and all of them the pot and pitcher are all clay, then you can say there is a seeming duality between the pot and pitcher, but not a real duality. Similarly, there is a seeming duality between the Guru and Shishya, but not real duality. This is what is revealed, and that seeming duality is not opposed to non-duality. Therefore, there is no rule that the knowledge of non-duality cannot take place as long as duality is. Even when duality is, knowledge of non-duality takes place, and that duality is not opposed to non-duality. Kintu tatha virodat anupajivyam pratyakshadehe. On the other hand, that knowledge of non-duality opposes or contradicts the duality, and therefore that perception is no more the basis. Because whatever perception reveals is all gone, disappears in the wake of the knowledge of non-duality. Therefore, pratyakshadehe tatvikam pramanyam badhyate iti. Therefore, that perception etc. are the tatvikam pramanyam, the means of knowledge. In reality, that is negated. They are means of knowledge only as long as knowledge has not taken place. Until then, they are okay. But once you come to know what is the truth of the Guru and what's the truth of the Shishya, then you realize that they do not remain separate from each other anymore. Then says Nyaya Nirnaya, kincha avagatim uddishya antaranga bahiranga sadhana vidhanadapi. Kincha avagatim uddishya. Keeping avagati, a knowledge in mind, the Upanishad also tells you how to gain that knowledge. Upanishad not only reveals the nature of knowledge, it also tells you iti kartavyata, how to gain that knowledge. So process of gaining knowledge also is described in the Upanishad. So anybody can get knowledge. Idea is that if there is a method, that is the peak of a mountain. If there is no road leading to that, then perhaps many people cannot reach that. But if there is a road, then anybody can reach there if there is a preparation. You must perhaps equip yourself, become fit, and gain training in mountaineering and things like that. So how to climb that mountain, how to reach that peak? Not only they describe what is a beautiful panoramic scenery when you reach the peak, but they also describe how to reach the peak, what preparation is required, what fitness is required for that. You see, there are these days now these marathons take place for charitable purposes. So people walk 10 miles, 16 miles, 22 miles, 26 miles. And if you walk 26 miles, then this fellow will contribute 100 rupees to you. So you need to find donors. Find 10 donors then. 10 donors, each contributes 100 rupees. So you have 1000 rupees, which you donate in that charity. Like Aim for Seva in Canada had this kind of a project, that there was somebody who was climbing Mount Kilimanjaro. So this person convinced that person, that was a woman. The look, you are climbing, why not make it a charitable climb, and whatever charity you get, donate to Aim for Seva. She agreed. So this event was publicized, that here she is going to climb Kilimanjaro, and you can contribute to that for Aim for Seva. Some $10,000 were collected. So, but before climbing, all kinds of preparations are done. Before those marathons, they go to trainers that I wish to participate in this 26 mile or 26 kilometer marathon. He says, you start walking 1 year in advance and every day walk this and then increase your fitness, and how to walk, they also teach you. How to move your limbs and everything is taught. We may just walk the way we want because it's a short walk, but when you want to walk for a long distance, that you do not get fatigued for that, how to efficiently walk, all of this they teach you. So not only people walk 26 kilometers, but there are also preparations as to how to do that, so anybody can prepare. Similarly, not only did Svetaketu and others came to know this, gain this knowledge, but then Upanishad also tells you how to get the knowledge. Antaranga Bahiranga Sadhanam. Antaranga Sadhana, the inner means, Bahiranga Sadhana, the outer means, Vidhanat, the Shastra also prescribes that. Therefore, Tadutpatti Ishtavya. If knowledge were never to take place, why should Shastra prescribe, do this and do that? If there was no Swarga, for example, then nobody can ever go to Swarga. Then why would Shastra says perform the Jyotishtoma Yaga, then you will reach Swarga. So not only Shastra describes how Swarga looks like, it tells you how to reach that. Therefore you have to accept it. Similarly, not only Upanishads describe non-duality, but they also teach you how to gain that knowledge of non-duality. For that is Bahiranga Sadhanam, Antaranga Sadhanam. So Bhashyakara says on page 380, Avagati Sadhana Nam Cha Shravanadinam Vedanu Vachanadinam Cha Vidhana. Avagati Sadhana Nam, the Sadhana, the means of knowledge. What are they? Shravanadinam Atmavare Drashtavya Shrutavya Mantavya निधिध्यासितव्यः। दस श्रवणादीनां विधानात् देयर इज एन एंजॉयमेंट दैट तद् विजिज्ञासितव्यः तद् अन्वेष्य अन्वेष्टव्यः स विजिज्ञासितव्यः। दैट यू मस्ट डू अन्वेषण, यू मस्ट एंटरटेन विजिज्ञासा, डिजायर टू नो, और श्रवणम मननम निधिध्यासनम, दिस इज अंतरंग साधनम, एंड ऑल्सो वेदानुवचनेन, तमेतम वेदानुवचनेन ब्राह्मणाः विविदिशन्ति यज्ञेन दानेन तपसा अनाशकेन, बाय रिसाइटल ऑफ वेदास, बाय यज्ञ, बाय दान, बाय तप, विच इज कर्मयोग, पीपल डिस्कवर जिज्ञासा विविदिशा मीनिंग द डिजायर टू नो, एंड देन श्रवणादि, सो दैट्स ए बहिरंग साधनम विच क्रिएट्स विविदिशा, एंड देन श्रवणादि अंतरंग साधनम विच क्रिएट्स नॉलेज, दिस ऑल प्रिस्क्राइब्ड। एंड देयरफॉर इट इज दैट दिस इज ऑल यू नो गोइंग ऑन फ्रॉम द टाइम लॉन्ग टाइम, एवं ज्ञात्वा कृतं कर्म पूर्वैरपि मुमुक्षुभिः, दिस आर ऑल एविडेंसेस देयर, व्हाट इज इट, कर्मण्येव हि संसिद्धिम् आस्थितः जनकादयः, एंड सो ऑन एंड सो फोर्थ, देयरफॉर दस देयर इज एविडेंस दैट देयर आर सीकर्स, देयर वर सीकर्स इन द पास्ट हु फॉलोड दिस पाथ, नॉट एकॉम्प्लिश द गोल। What is it in the fourth chapter? Janma karma cha me divyam evam yo veti tattvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma nati naiti mamedi soj vitarag bhayak krodaha manmayaha मामुपासिता बहवो ज्ञान तपसा हूताः मद्भावम् आगताः, बहवः ज्ञान तपसा पूताः, लॉर्ड कृष्णा सेज दैट मेनी मेनी एस्पिरेंट्स हु गेन प्योरिफिकेशन बाय द पेनेंस ऑफ नॉलेज मद्भावम् आगताः, दे रीच माय स्टेट, मीनिंग दे बिकेम वन विथ मी, दे गेन द आइडेंटिटी विथ मी, so that is, then you can't say it doesn't take place. Okay, I think we'll stop here today. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेदि देविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरिः ओम।